Hello and welcome to another episode of Talking Politics, where we look at the stories behind the headlines in domestic politics. And I'm Nistula Hebbar, the political editor of The Hindu. Now, this week, the third iteration of the Modi government completes 100 days. And in the week following, there will be much analysis on the decisions taken by this new NDA government and how it has negotiated its way through these 100 days. An unusual situation of presiding over a coalition government for Prime Minister Narendra Modi. Now, this episode will also be looking at the same, but largely in terms of political management and messaging. When the BJP, for the first time in a decade, stopped short of a full majority in the Lok Sabha with the results of the general elections of 2024, there was no doubt in anyone's mind that this was a return to coalition politics of a pre-2014, 30-year period pre-2014, and this was after a gap of 10 years. In such a situation, there were two ways in which I see that there can be a political assessment of the 100 days of Modi 3.0. Now, let's start with the internal dynamics of the internal challenges that Prime Minister Modi has dealt with, namely within his ideological family of the Sangh Parivar. Even before the results of the Lok Sabha elections poured in, the RSS, the ideological mothership of the BJP, had made its displeasure with the way political management was being affected by the BJP well known. They didn't like that there was splitting of parties like the Shiv Sena and the NCP, addition to the BJP ranks of people previously anathema to the party ideologically like Ajit Pawar of the NCP, and the quick progression of new recruits poached from other parties within the BJP compared to older party workers who've been associated with the party for a long time but who found a career stagnation within. BJP President JP Nadda's statement during an interview that the BJP was now saksham or able in terms of electioneering without dipping into the RSS's resources was also not taken well by the RSS. The reduced numbers of the BJP, therefore, gave the RSS the in that it needed to intervene in BJP's organizational structure, which it had not been able to do in the last 10 years with a very, very dominating, electorally powerful prime minister at the helm of affairs who wanted to run the BJP the way he wanted to run it. And the old connectivity between the RSS and the BJP had been frayed somewhat because of that. But since the numbers had come down, the RSS felt that this was the right time to intervene and establish some of its own dominance in the situation. It was made very clear that the new president of the BJP, since Mr. Nadda was on extension anyway, was to have an RSS imprint. The RSS had said, according to sources, that the appointment of a working president should be done quickly before the RSS coordination meeting with all its affiliated organizations that was held in Palakkad at the end of August, beginning September. But the BJP managed to postpone that requirement by announcing an election calendar for internal polls. And more importantly, by conceding on the return of RSS man Ram Madhav as BJP poll in charge for the crucial assembly polls in Jammu and Kashmir. The pull and push between the BJP and the RSS has now somewhat settled from a state of bitterness and anger to one of adjustments, of being members of the same ideological family and an understanding that it serves the RSS to help the BJP stay in power. So therefore, with this buying of a little time to maintain their dominance within the BJP, on conceding some ground to the RSS and retaining some for themselves, it seems as though Prime Minister Narendra Modi has managed to explain to the RSS that him being in power and at the helm of a BJP government is what suits the RSS best, and therefore there is no point in an all-out war. This is all in the family. Let's keep it within the family. And that is the situation that exists as of now between the BJP and the RSS. Now, these were the internal dynamics that happened, that played out in the last 100 days. What about the external challenges of coalition partners? In these 100 days, Prime Minister Modi has also had to negotiate a coalition, a first for his time. From his time as Gujarat Chief Minister and as Prime Minister, he's never headed a coalition. He's always had the numbers for a single party rule. This is a new situation for Prime Minister Narendra Modi. Now, in this period, coalition partners, otherwise stalwart in support of the NDA government and having expressed that a stable NDA government at the centre also suits them, have been asserting nevertheless, and the BJP has been feeling its effects. While appointments of ministers and members within the PMO were as they were in Modi 2.0 when the BJP had got 303 seats, it was in policy and legislation that the heat was felt. The government had to refer its first major bill, the Waqf Amendment Bill, to a joint parliamentary committee after pressure from allies like the Telugu Desam Party, the Janata Dal United and the Chirag Paswan-led Lok Jan Shakti Party, who were anxious to assure the Muslim community that their rights would not be infringed upon. It was made very clear that while the BJP may benefit electorally from polarization, the allies did not. And the allies still wanted the support of all communities, minority communities as well. And therefore, they did not want it to be known that they were part of a government which was bringing this bill, which Muslim community members had a lot of misgivings about. Now, the government also had to walk back on lateral entries to the UPSC. These were single point entries. So therefore, the principle of reservations did not apply to these appointments, to government jobs. And a lot of political blowback happened also from within the government. Chirag Paswan was extremely vocal on this issue, and the government had to walk back from that issue. And they also had to quickly react to the Supreme Court's judgment on subcategorizations of scheduled castes, which also had an observation by one of the judges that a creamy layer should be implemented with regard to the scheduled caste category for reservations as well. This was completely refuted by the government. First, Prime Minister Narendra Modi made that declaration to a group of scheduled caste MPs from the BJP, and then the Union Cabinet also passed a resolution to that effect. Even junior allies like Apna Dal's Anupriya Patel has flexed her muscles. She wrote to UP Chief Minister Yogi Adityanath that vacancies for OBCs in state government jobs should be filled soon. Now, these would show that the government was a bit wobbly, and despite this being the strongest coalition government in independent India's history, it was still a coalition. Prime Minister Narendra Modi has, however, been negotiating the boundaries of this coalition as well. A mechanism for all allies to meet once a month has been set up, with Defence Minister Rajnath Singh emerging as a key figure in consensus building. Also, Prime Minister Modi's speech during his Independence Day address from the Red Fort this year touched on a secular civil code, a reconfiguration of a uniform civil code. It's a key ideological touchstone for the BJP and the Sangh Parivar, not so much for his allies. Now, this was a signal to his allies that he would not be like former Prime Minister Vajpayee, who suspended the three core issues of the Sangh and the BJP, that is the abrogation of Article 370 of the Constitution, according special status to Jammu and Kashmir, the construction of a Ram temple in Ayodhya, and the implementation of a uniform civil code in favor of an agenda for governance for the NDA. It was also a signal to his own ideological family that he was still holding the ideological line, that he was still the Prime Minister who had completed at least two out of these three core issues the moment he had the numbers to do it, and that he was still extremely ideologically committed. He was speaking to his base in that speech. All of this, all of these signals and messaging, all of this will be tested in times to come, with four tough assembly polls on the horizon: Jammu and Kashmir, Haryana, Jharkhand and Maharashtra. If the BJP loses these polls, there will be a massive erosion of the political authority enjoyed by Prime Minister Modi, with a resurgent opposition extremely conscious about it. If the polls result in even Stevens, or they manage to not do so badly, then a recoup of this authority could be attempted. The first 100 days to me, therefore, seem like Prime Minister Modi testing the boundaries of what he can get away with as he grapples with handling a coalition government for the first time in his political career. Many more innovations, I feel, are up ahead. We will return to the story later at a point where it reaches another flex. As for this week, this is all I have for you. Thank you so much for watching, and do not forget to subscribe to the Hindu's YouTube channel if you want more content of this kind. Thank you so much. I'll see you next week.